Good evening with Sports Night. I'm Anne-Marie Burke. Now, the Garfield Sobers Gymnasium is on schedule to be reopened in a couple of months. A number of delegates, including Sports Minister Stephen Lashley, Interim CEO of the National Sports Council Jerry Blenman, and Ambassador of the Republic of China Wang Ke, toured the establishment. The three were guided through the process of the renovations and were also given insight into how soon the facility would be available. CBC's Mark Seal has the details.
Minister Lashley has stressed the importance of the facility being reopened and says that the government was proactive in making sure that the gym was fixed before it was completely unusable. He says that once it's reopened, the gymnasium will be marketed to host regional and international competitions.
There is a component of the integration that, with the agreement of the unions, we have actually started, because we have had on the closure of the temporary closure of the gymnasium, we have transferred the staff to Kensington Oval, and therefore we've actually integrated some aspects of the staff, the security, general workers and so on, in providing services at Kensington Oval. We have been determined, of course, to maintain the levels of employment, but we've done it in a way where we have affected some savings in relation to what happens at Komi. And that, of course, is in its trial stages, and we have been reviewing that, but I think that's a good start to the integration.
Minister Lashley says that there is a proposal on the table for Kensington Oval Management Inc. and the Sir Garfield Sober Sports Complex Gymnasium Limited. He says the proposal needs to be formally signed by the Cabinet.
We certainly have a lot of plans in place to ensure that we could actually market the gymnasium in a way that would allow us to attract major international sporting activities of an indoor nature. Currently, of course, before these renovations, the gymnasium could not, for example, host international teams, particularly in the area of basketball, volleyball, and other indoor sports. With the completion of the gymnasium, the vision of an international quality floor, this gymnasium then can be a very pivotal part of the marketing of our sporting program.
Although the integration has not been completely finalized, Minister Lashley says that they are already working together.
The overall intention, of course, is to effect efficiencies and to ensure that we could actually have a leaner organization, but one that is attuned to the modern demands of what is required in terms of not only the provision of facilities, but in providing the level of sporting, the level of sports in Barbados that we know that we can deliver.
Mark Seal, CBC Sports.
Barbados men's hockey team will have to be at their best tomorrow when they take on Japan in a quarterfinal match at the Hockey World League Round 2 tournament currently underway in Trinidad and Tobago. To qualify for the World Cup, the local boys will have to make it to the semi-final stage, which will be contested in London later in June. Barbados lost their three previous games, 2-1 to Chile, 7-1 to the USA and 10-0 to Canada. But still, they have three remaining games to play. Tomorrow's match is scheduled for 5:45 p.m. And welcome back to Sports Night. Now, the West Indies team will be looking to level the format series 1-1 as they face Pakistan in the second T20 International at the Queen's Park Oval in Trinidad tomorrow. Having lost the first match due to a poor batting display at Kensington Oval, the boys will be hoping to bounce back. Captain Carlos Brathwaite says they have to do a better job of progressing through the overs.
In Pakistan, we found ourselves 20 for 3 and 20 for 4 at the end of the first 6. We moved on, we progressed to 34 for 1, which we were happy with at the end of the 6. And now it's just a matter of understanding what we did well in the first 6, replicating that, but then taking it a step further and progressing between 6 and 14 as well, which has always been a problem area for the West Indies, but one which we are addressing. And we're doing it in stages. Again, we conquered the first 6 in our opinion, and it's just a matter now, again, 6 to 14, right? If we can have the first 6, the last 6, and then be a lot better between 6 and 14. We're sure we can put it 150 plus. And that gives us a better fighting chance when we go to bowl.
And live coverage will be on 94.7 FM and also on MCTV channels 118. And that starts from 12:30 p.m. Well, the Barbados Football Association has a new technical director. 13 months after the position became vacant, the man taking up the role is Ahmed Mohamed, a 37-year-old Swiss national who becomes the youngest person to fill that role here in Barbados. Now, he comes with a ton of experience, dating back as far as 2001. Contracted for an initial 11 months with the possibility of an extension to 2 years, he has as his mandate to set the platform for developing the sport from the junior to the senior level. And he's asking for cooperation and patience as overnight results are just not a reality. In speaking to the media, Mohamed revealed that his intention is to work with all teams from the juniors to the seniors as he aims to set that strong platform. Barbados Football Association President Randy Harris said choosing a technical director was not an easy task as they started with 116 candidates, but he's confident Mohamed is the right choice. Mohamed said in addition to boosting the island's football, he also wants to boost the international coaching level from the current FIFA C level to at least the B level. Not only is he qualified on paper, but he shares the vision of the BFA in taking the sport further. Mohamed officially started his job today and has as his first big assignment preparing and leading the men's national team to the Windward Islands tournament set for June. Now, action in the round of 16 in the Mass United Insurance Clash of the Titans Road Tennis Tournament continued last night at the Dover Hard Courts. CBC's Damien Best has a roundup of some of the matches.
Round of 16 Clash of the Titans. Ladies first up, Shireen Ward closest to the screen versus Miranda Manning. Manning forearm gets the point, but Ward had a sizable lead in the first game, 11-4, and was taking advantage of the mistakes from Manning. Ward wrapping up the first game 21-7, going cross court. Second game, Manning fared much better, locking the score at 17. Ward with back-to-back errors, but Ward would prevail in two straight, 21-7, 21-17. Abbey playboy Clark next up against Darius Gaskin, aka Baracus. Clark with some well-calculated moves picks a spot down the line. Winner. Clark going up 12-5 with another dart. He would indeed take the first game 21-11. In the second, Gaskin, the number 5 seed, with work to do. But Clark still in control. Spicy indeed. Something had to give, and Gaskin looking to reverse the magic gets the point. Very next play, more eye candy. Straight drive out the middle. Skip ahead, Clark on his heels, and Gaskin searching for the winner. Not this time. We're tied at 15. Gaskin, though, taking the lead 19-18. Good use of the angle. The highlight, though, for me, of the second game, both players rallying for all they're worth. Gaskin leveling the set at one apiece, 21-19. In the third, this one wide open now, aggression from Clark. As they turn once more, Gaskin with the finish line in sight, the smash to end the point. He goes on to wrap up the third, 21-16, Clark wide of the target. In the final set of the night then, Ryan Hall playing Dario Hines, aka CR7, in the far court. First point to Hall. In fact, the first game was very keen. Hines, elegant backarm return, and Hall into the advertising. Several lead changes later, Hines would open his account at 21-19. Second game, Hall was found wanting when it mattered the most. Hines finds the corner of the court with precision. Hall did have his moments. The injection, absolutely lethal. But trailing 9-16, Hall just had too much work to do, digging himself a hole as Hines going on to take the victory, winning the second, 21-14. Damien Best, CBC Sports.
Well, Welcome back to Sports Night. Well, a total of 21 medals from just 15 athletes was gained at the recently concluded 25th annual Porigen Special Olympics held at the Porigen Penal Sports Ground in the Saint Village in Trinidad and Tobago. Competing against 1,500 students in their sixth year, the Barbadian athletes from Erdison Special Needs School, Irving Wilson, Ellerton, Ann Hill, Charles F. Room Annex, and Eagle Hall won 2 gold and 19 bronze medals. Natalie Allen, a teacher at Ellerton, says it was a very good experience for the students, and she commended top athlete Mwamba Brung for his 1 gold and 2 bronze medals.
We performed well, considering that it was 1,500 children, and we were only taking a small contingent of 15 children. So for me, we did well, and it's not just about the meet, but it's about the experience of traveling and being able to go on the airplane for the first time. It's all of those other educational experiences that the children. Mwambo, he's at Erdison Special School, and he's one of the top athletes. He would have participated in NAPSA as well. He's a long distance runner, and he works really, really hard. That is his gift.
Organizer Hamilton Lashie believes that the Ministry of Education should make it mandatory for all schools to attend the local Special Olympics event, which is held annually.
The Special Olympics is happening, happens in Barbados every year. And I feel that the Ministry of Education should make it mandatory that almost every single school set the number of vehicles of every school to attend the Special Olympics. And I think the participation by schools throughout Barbados at the Special Olympics is something that needs to be addressed in a matter of extreme urgency. Because then when you go to Special Olympics, you know, the stands are not good. So the Ministry of Education has to make it mandatory that all of the schools in Barbados send some of their children to attend the Special Olympics. And then they will have a greater appreciation of the challenges that sometimes these children have to go through.
Time now to tell you what's happening in sports on Thursday. Well, track and field gets all the attention from 9 a.m. with day 5 of BSAC at the National Stadium. Live coverage will be on CBC TV 8 from the start, along with radio coverage on 94.7 FM. Now, across the waters in Trinidad and Tobago, the West Indies and Pakistan will do battle in the second T20 at the Queen's Park Oval. Live coverage is on MCTV Channel 118. Meanwhile, Barbados will take on Japan in the quarterfinals of Men's Hockey World League Round 2 competition, also in Trinidad. That game gets underway at 5:45 p.m. Then 15 minutes later, a BABA Premier League doubleheader gets going at the BCC Gym. At 6 o'clock, Station Hill Cavaliers will clash with Pan American International Insurance Corporation Warrens. Then in the nightcap game, Urban Vice St. John Sonics will oppose Hilton Resort Barbados Warriors at 8 o'clock. During that time, the Mass United Insurance Clash of the Titans Raw Tennis Tournament Round of 16 will be in full swing. 6 games are on the cards, including matchups in the ladies section at the Dover Hard Course in St. Lawrence Gap. Now that's Sports Night for Wednesday. Tune in tomorrow for our next edition. I'm Anne-Marie Burke. Good night.
CBC TV 8 in beautiful Barbados.